Hello, everyone. Welcome to Washington Gun Law TV. I'm Washington Gun Law President William Kirk. Thanks for joining us. Hey, as you know, I'm always encouraging all of you viewers out there to add comments and discussions down below. And I've had this topic come up with quite a bit of frequency. And while I've given some very specific answers to some very specific questions, I felt this is a good opportunity for us to have a little candid discussion about the truth about gun modifications in Washington State. Okay, before we get rolling, you guys know the drill. If you like this video, go ahead and click the like button down below. If you want to stay up to date on issues related to your Second Amendment rights, go ahead and click the subscribe button. Click the little bell logo if you want to be notified about new videos when we post them. And most importantly, let's keep the comments and discussions coming. That's how we're going to make sure we get our videos out to more lawful and responsible gun owners like yourself. Okay, so from time to time, and with some bit of frequency, I will get questions that are related to specific modifications of firearms. Can I drop this trigger in? Can I put this optic on? Or something to that effect. And listen, one of the really neat things about firearms is that, yeah, we can modify our weapons. We can modify our handguns. We can modify our rifles. Semi-automatic rifles is literally like an erector set of different things that we can do, different add-ons, different elements that we can add to our platform. And that is one of the really cool things. And I preach all the time here at Washington Gun Law about how there sometimes is a difference between what we have the right to do and what we should do. So let's talk about what we have the right to do first, okay? In Washington State, if we take a look at the laws that outlaw firearms, which is primarily RCW 9.41.190, and it lists all the firearms, we know that we can't do certain modifications to firearms because the law makes it very clear. For example, we cannot take a regular shotgun and saw down the barrel to anything less than 18 inches. We have an unlawful short barrel shotgun at that point. We can't take a rifle and saw down the barrel to anything less than 16 inches. Otherwise, we have an SBR. Or more likely, we can't take an AR lower with a 16 or longer inch barrel on top. Take that upper off, drop a 10.5-inch barrel on there. It's going to look really cool. It's going to fire really nice. But you're in possession of an SBR at that point, and you're a felon on two different levels. And we're going to get into some of that in a little bit, too. We can't add a bump stock to our firearm. That's illegal under both state law and federal law. We can't add a silencer, or what I like to call a suppressor, to our firearm unless we've gone through all the appropriate ATF channels. We can't modify our gun in any way, shape, or form to make it fully automatic. Now, most of these should come as common sense to all of us, and if you've been watching this channel even a few times, you would readily know that. But when it comes to making modifications on our firearms that are more likely to be made, I'm going to kind of break them down into about four different categories. All right, the first one is going to be modifications to the trigger. Second one is going to be modifications to the optics. Third one is going to be to accessorize our firearms with other things that are just essentially accessories to it. And then finally, we're going to talk about changing the appearance of our firearm, adding skins or other things like that to it. Okay, as a bottom line rule, unless it's prohibited in RCW 9.41.190, just about any other modification that you can do to a firearm in Washington State is lawful. Let me say that again. Just about any modification that you can do to your firearm, whether it's a shotgun, rifle, semi-automatic rifle, handgun, pistol, whatever you want to call it, okay, you can do just about any modification. Can you put post-factory triggers in your semi-automatic assault rifle and your handgun? You most certainly may. Now, we've done some issues as it relates to the rare breed trigger. I'll put the links for that down below. But beyond that, almost all of your post-factory AR triggers, post-factory modified triggers that you can put into your Glock or other handguns that you may have, yes, they are all perfectly legal. The thing that we need to talk about today, though, is, yes, you got the right to do all these things. You can make just about any modification. If you want to add this to it or add that or make it look like that, yeah, you can do that. And so you have the right to do that. Should you do that? Let's talk about triggers first. Okay, Let's say we have a handgun. Let's take a very normal Glock 19, one of the most popular handguns known to man. And we decide that we want to put a post-production trigger in there, and we want to have an extremely light trigger pull. We want something perhaps even less than 3.5 pounds. Now, we can discuss the wisdom of whether or not you should have that. Is that unlawful? No, it's not. Do you have the right to do it? Yes, you do. Should you do it? I would caution you for a couple of things. Number one, if we do end up in a situation where we are arguably thinking about having to use lethal force, it is my opinion, and granted it is only my opinion, so take it for what it is worth, that that first pull of the trigger should be an incredibly intentional act. I hate to see cases in which people show poor trigger discipline, put the finger on the trigger too quick, and have an accidental discharge because of a light trigger. The other thing is this, is the accidental discharges, and we see this. Now, I know that there are some firearms that have failed drop tests, but certainly for people who are pulling the firearm in or out of a holster, for those of us who aren't as well-versed in handguns, for those of us who show very poor trigger discipline, and I see you at the range all the time, so you guys know who you are, okay? An extremely light trigger absolutely increases the probability of an accidental discharge. An accidental discharge exponentially increases the likelihood that someone could be seriously injured. And so while you might be able to avoid some criminal liability in the event of an accidental discharge, do you think that the plaintiff's lawyer, when they're suing you because you accidentally paralyzed the woman at the range with an accidental discharge, do you think that your trigger modifications, making that a feather trigger, a hair trigger, if you would, are going to be used against you? It most certainly will. So I do caution people that I get the need to have good performance on your firearms. I get the need that everyone has their own fit. But please be aware that when you start modifying that trigger, if you end up in a lawful self-defense situation, or worse yet, you end up in a situation where you're being sued because of a discharge, those trigger modifications undoubtedly will be used against you. Okay, so let's talk about optics. Other than some limitations on the use of night vision optics, there are no other restrictions in Washington State. I'll put a link for the video about the night vision restrictions there. So whether you want to put fiber optic sights, you want to put red dot sights, you want to put some post-production sight on your firearm, again, you absolutely have the right to do it. Now, is it something that you should do? Well, I don't see sights necessarily used by prosecutions as much as some of the other modifications I do. And I certainly do believe that if, God forbid, that you are in a situation in which you do have to pull the trigger in self-defense, you want to be as accurate as humanly possible. Now, where I have seen some issues is people who put a combination of sights on there because it does make them look perhaps a little more gung-ho than their defense attorney may have wanted to be. So having both a laser pointing sight as well as a red dot and a flashlight all attached to your firearm at the same time can be a little overboard. I think there's a question of how functional it would be at that point. But again, that's a personal preference. So I don't find as near many problems with optics as I do necessarily with trigger modifications. Now, the next one, however, we do see things, and it's about accessorizing. Now, as we know, one of the great things about the AR platform is all the different accessories that we can get for that. But there are some things that you need to be aware of. First of all, for those of you that are new to the AR platform, there is always a strong desire to buy a lower receiver, buy a separate upper receiver, buy the bolt carrier group, the charging handle, some optics, slap it all together, and away you go. And can you do that? Yes, you can. Is it fun? It actually is a lot of fun to do. But here's the thing you need to be aware of. If our lower receiver has a rifle brace on it, something like this, and not a pistol brace, which looks more like this, then we have to make sure that on a rifle braced lower, we are putting an upper receiver with at least a 16-inch barrel. If we have purchased an AR with a 16-inch barrel and you want to swap that upper out, but you want to swap it out with a 10.5-inch barrel, please understand at that point, that modification is creating a short barrel rifle. You are a felon both on the state and federal level at that point. Now, there's other modifications that you see. Obviously, optics is a big thing, lighting, bipods, and things like that. I want to talk about the foregrip. The foregrip is on an AR rifle, again, something like this here, is a very useful tool for helping stabilize the rifle and help make sure that the rifle is properly shouldered. However, let us remember when it comes to AR pistols that they are defined both by federal law and subsequently by state law as a pistol because they are designed to be fired, theoretically, with one hand. If we start putting foregrips on AR pistols, what we are doing is communicating to law enforcement that the intent of that foregrip is to bring the firearm closer and more snug to the shooting shoulder. Therefore, it is a rifle which is meant, it is a firearm, I should say, which is now intended to be fired from the shoulder, and we're getting back into the SBR range. And again, if you want to know what the ATF has been thinking about that, we'll put a link for a video we did about the four-point system that the ATF kicked around about how they were going to try to classify most AR pistols as short barrel rifles. Now, there's also a reality that we have to have about the difference between the stuff we should take to the range and the difference between the stuff that we should actually carry with us. I'll give you an example. We know that Glock has a lot of accessories that we can purchase, a lot of post-production things, including magazines. You can go out and buy 30, 40, 50, 60 round magazines for your Glock 19. Are they cool to take to the range? Yeah, they probably are pretty cool to take to the range. Is that the magazine that you should be carrying when concealed carrying? I had a colleague a number of years ago who had to defend an individual who had shot another individual, killing him, and had claimed self-defense. He had, I believe it was a Glock 19, might have been a Glock 17, I don't specifically recall. The standard magazine for that firearm was, I believe, 15 or 17 rounds. The problem is he had a 33-round magazine at the time that the shooting occurred, and he managed to empty that entire magazine. The existence of that magazine, the fact that he ended up pulling the trigger as many times as he did, ultimately were some of the factors that led to his conviction for murder. Now, the final thing I want to talk about, and this is perhaps the one I might have the biggest problem with, and that is changing the appearance of her gun. And I'm talking about things such as putting skins on there, or changing the dust cover so it reads something like this, or putting the Punisher on our firearm. Yes, does it look cool? It kind of does look cool. How is a prosecuting attorney or plaintiff's counsel going to interpret that, though? And therein lies the big problem. If there is a decision as to whether or not you're some trigger-happy vigilante or you acted in lawful self-defense, trust me, the appearance of your firearm will matter greatly to the detectives, it will matter greatly to the prosecution, and yes, it will matter to the jury as well. Same goes if you are involved in a civil suit over what you believe to be a lawful use of self-defense, lethal force. Yes, if you have the Punisher on your firearm, if you have something that looks like this on your firearm, yes, is that going to be used against you? It most certainly will. Some of you may recall an incident in 2016 from Mesa, Arizona, in which a member of their SWAT team was brought up on murder charges because after being called to the scene of a potential active shooter, he confronted the individual carrying his own personal SBR from home, which he was using as his SWAT duty weapon, and ordered the individual onto the ground and to crawl to his location. As the individual was crawling to his location, his shorts began to slide off of him, so at one point he reached down to pull his shorts back up. The SWAT member, believing that he was reaching for a firearm, fired upon him multiple times, killing him. On the dust cover of his SBR, the following was sketched. And that was Exhibit A in his murder trial, in which the prosecution attempted to prove that he was nothing but a trigger-happy vigilante who was looking for reasons to shoot him. Now, fortunately for the detective, it did result in a verdict in his favor because the jury did believe it was reasonable that he could have felt that the individual was reaching for a handgun. But had it not been for that dust cover, I don't know if this case would have actually ever been filed. So the bottom line is this. Can you make modifications to your gun? You most certainly can. Do you have the right to do so? With very limited exceptions, you have the right to make just about any modification you want. So does the right to do so exist? Yes, it does. Is it something you should do, however? That is the most important question, because we have to always be mindful that any modifications we make to our firearm, even if our intent is to increase the performance, increase our proficiency in the use of the firearm, let us remember how the other side and or people in the jury box may view it. Listen, you may have more questions about firearm modifications or anything related to your Second Amendment rights, and if you do, don't ever hesitate to contact us at WashingtonGunLaw.com Or, of course, you can call us directly at 425-765-0487. Listen, part of being a lawful and responsible gun owner, like we talk about all the time here at Washington Gun Law, is to know what the law is in every situation and how it applies to you in any instance that you may find yourself. Until next time, thanks for watching, and stay safe.